Excited about the opportunity to watch on YouTube, you can go downstairs and see it. if that really makes you happy, but we're glad to have people here and to be worshiping together. And somebody asked me early on, I said, why do you have the windows open? I said, because there haven't been people here in 3 months. So we figured we'd get the smell out. So we're gonna sing together. So here's the thing, all right? And I talked about this last week. I can't tell you not to sing. How does that sound?
That sounds wonderful.
All right. so that's the way that it works. I'm going to use the governor's method of not saying things. That's what I'm going to do. So let's join together. Let's Soul on Fire.
I'm running for your heart. Still I am a soul on fire, Lord. I'm running for your way. I'm waiting for the day when Especially to my neighbors, and not to give credit to my acquaintances.
stored up for those who fear you, and worked for those who take refuge in you, in the sight of the children of mankind.
When you uncover your presence, you hide them from the loss of men. You store them in shelter from the strife of tongues.
Blessed be the Lord, for he has wondrously shown his steadfast love to me. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts in pride. Be strong, and let your heart take courage, all of you who wait for the Lord. You can be seated. We sing this song together. It's been a while since we did this one, speaking about our God and how he transcends even our ability to measure how much he transcends us.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
difficult when you can actually come in physical contact with people that disappear. So some of the things that we normally would do are, you know, take our offering, which right now under the guidance that we're under, we can't do that, and have announcements, which of course most of what we would announce had to be canceled because we couldn't do things. So we do have a couple things that are going on. There's a couple things in the bulletin let you know about our family Bible studies, home Bible studies, whatever we call them. Are winding down for the summer. My group is meeting till the end of June. I believe Ray's group ended this week.
We're meeting this week.
And Greg's group is this week. And Bob's group is done for the summer. Hey, Bob just gives me the... he's like, we're tired of Zoom. We don't want to do it anymore. So our group met here on Tuesday night and social distanced and had people on video and kind of this hybrid thing where you couldn't get a camera that could actually see everybody all at once. And so it's an awkward time. And we are, you know, we're waiting for guidance to be able to try to conform to what's being asked of us in terms of occupancy and health and everything. But we'd really like to get things going. And of course, today we were going to be outside, and then that Noahic deluge happened last night. I mean, the forecast was for showers, and we were practicing. Nicole and I were practicing, and Arrow came from her room. She says, "Didn't we have stuff out in the yard?" And I was like, "No, it's fine. It's just a little rain." And then I stopped and listened, and I went out to get the stuff out of my yard, and I went out in, I think, the absolute worst part of it. I had a headlamp on and my, you know, my hiking raincoat. I couldn't see 2 feet in front of me. But I also didn't want my recycling bin and the kiddie pool that we use for the dogs to wind up in the neighbor's yard. So, you know, I was trying to salvage stuff in the yard, you ever tried to carry a kiddie pool in a rainstorm? It's an interesting experience. Anyway, so we were going to be outside with the field or so. But we did come up with an alternate plan. If it rains the night before, but it still dries out, a way to use our driveway, which makes sense, use our parking lot to be able to have a service outside. So we're not necessarily tied in with doing all the overflow stuff. And I mean, with the group we have now, it worked out. We were able to spread everybody out and everybody was okay. As people start filtering in, hopefully we'll never have to use that overflow thing and everything will work out. So groups, and then ladies Bible study, or ladies group is done for the year. They finished in May. They'll pick back up in September. We were planning some men's stuff, but obviously that's going to get pushed until fall. And youth group is meeting, I think, next Sunday, and then they're going to be done for the summer, and they're planning to meet in person here, social distancing and all that stuff. I still think there are two money-making possibilities here if you guys get on the horse now. All right, so number one is if you can figure out a way to make these to taste like food, I think you could make a small fortune. And the other one, which is a little more complicated, I call it the sacred spacer. And if somebody just slaps stickers on pool noodles that are 6 feet long, so people could just sit in church and just swing their and say, "See, we're in social distance, right?" You know, for a very brief time, it would be like Pogs or NHL NHL cards or things like that. They were just for a very Beanie Babies for a moment. You would make a lot of money. Yeah. But anyway, we're dealing with all the restrictions and requirements and everything. So obviously, right now it looks like this summer we probably won't be doing our typical barbecues and things like that. But we'll see how things shake out. Things are barriers are coming down quickly. So I think that in a week or two we're going to get additional guidance from the governor and things will open up a little bit, and that'll be good. You know, and there are all kinds of things to praise the Lord for this week. I mean, I know Ryan is excited because the NBA is coming back. And 3 months without sports for a sports writer is not exactly the greatest situation. And wedding venues are going to be opening up, and restaurants are opening up, and things are coming back. So we want to continue to pray for those who are dealing with the COVID-19 things. Specifically, right now, Russ Russ Payne has, his wife is at Hillsborough as a patient, and then, or as a resident, and then he has at least three family members working there. That they're constantly being screened, and so that's a concern for him. We have a lot of babies coming, and so I don't know if you got a chance, you saw in the email, but Sean and Dee, their daughter Danielle, had her baby, and so Sean's grandpa name is Buddy, which I think is absolutely fantastic. Has there ever been a grandfather name more appropriate to a person than Sean be called Buddy? And so that's awesome. And Mimi Mimi for Dee. And so we're excited for them, Danielle and Nick, there were like this rash of weddings all at once, and sometimes I get the names wrong. But then Ashley is expecting, and Katie Meisner is expecting up in Nova Scotia pretty soon. What?
Leah
Bush. I was getting there. Or not Bush anymore. Not Bush anymore. And I just did. My wife does that all the time. She says people by their maiden names, and I did it because. So we've got a lot going on. Haley just had her baby, and so it's a season of life. I mean, sometimes we get so obsessed with darkness and death. You know, because that seems to be all that's on the news. We get it. I mean, I wasn't alive during the Vietnam War, but this seems a lot like the news coverage I've seen from Vietnam, where every day was just another body count. You know, and you just waited for it to come up, and so it's nice to think about life and joy and happiness and celebration instead of all the restrictions. So, and there's every indication right now the kids will actually go back to school in September. Which parents are celebrating. Y'all made fun of homeschoolers before! I know, honestly, the teachers are ready for the kids to go back to school because the distance education thing was hard. So we'll just continue to pray that everything moves well, that nobody does anything dumb, and we're able to continue to progress toward the freedom that we should be enjoying. So. Continue to pray for everybody that's involved. We still have a lot of frontline workers. If you saw the prayer request, I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on. Hannah Godze shared two prayer requests that her husband had been furloughed. So pray that he gets back to work. And then he has a sister who's not doing well in Ghana, and he can't go. And Yao is kind of the head of the household. So what? She did pass away. Okay. So I didn't get that notice. So he can't go to Ghana. So I'm not even going to try to pronounce her name. So you can just pray for them and that family. That's difficult. It's a difficult situation to be in. It's one thing to have somebody local pass away, but somebody that distance. Why don't we join in a word of prayer? And then we're going to get into scriptures, and we'll move along. Heavenly Father, we do lift up the Kadazi family and the 1-2 punch this week. And Lord, we just pray that you would give Yao grace and patience as he's dealing with a difficult situation on both his employment and family sides. Lord, we pray for the family in Ghana. I don't know how many relatives are there and all the details of that. Lord, but with small children and everything else going on. Lord, we pray for Russ Payne's family at Hillsborough. Lord, we pray that you will continue to protect them, keep them testing negative. And Lord, I pray that you would open an opportunity for Russ to be able to see his wife, to be able to go and visit her. Lord, that the restrictions would be set, the guidelines would be set in such a way that can happen. I know that that's not just him. It's a case across the country. Of people in long-term care facilities, your family not able to see them. Lord, for all those that are having children, and I know that at least Nick was able to be in with Danielle, but the rest of the family wasn't able to see the baby until she came home. Lord, we pray that you give the hospitals wisdom, those of our congregation working as nurses and doctors and hospital technicians and employees and support in so many different ways that they're involved. Lord, we thank you for those who are able to maintain their jobs. Lord, we thank you for the good indicators of employment coming out this week. Lord, we pray that we will continue this recovery, that it will you will superintend it supernaturally, and you will be restored to the new normal quicker than everybody expects. Lord, lift up our families and our gathering together as a congregation, Lord, that we might glorify you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. So I want to take a moment today. We're in the book of Philippians, and we're going to be in Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 12. And I want to share some thoughts. I'm not going to get into the politics and the craziness of what's been going on. But I never anticipated when I joked around that on January 1st, 2021, we were going to have a hindsight is 2020 party. I never thought when I joked around that I might actually be planning that party, because frankly, I can't wait for 2020 to be gone. This has been quite a year. But we have to remember that what we're living in, all right, the crisis that we're facing, is precisely a crisis because of the blessings that we have. The world that we live in today, in terms of technology and medicine and government and infrastructure, gets through things like this without too much inconvenience. Yeah, it was weird when nobody could get toilet paper. It was odd to watch farmers be dumping milk. It's strange and a little bit eerie and a little bizarre to see people in tactical gear on the streets of the cities of the country. But you have to remember that these things are anomalies because of the extraordinary blessings we have as a society and as a culture. It's very different. Most of human history has been very different from what we've been through. And the Roman world was no different than that. Now, we're going to get into this passage, but I just want you to understand the world, real quick, that the Christians in Philippi lived in. To be a Christian in the late Julio-Claudian era of the Roman world was to be a non-person. Because you weren't a Gentile anymore, but you also weren't a Jew. And Jews had special protections that they didn't want extended to the Christians. They were exempt from a lot of taxes. They just had a bunch of different rules because they had really helped Julius Caesar come to power, and so he had granted them a lot of freedoms that other people in the kingdom didn't have. And the Jews believed that if you were accepting somebody as your Messiah, you were no longer a part of their group. And so Jewish believers were kind of exiled from their Jewish roots and all the privileges of that. But then Gentile believers, who most of the Philippians were, they were kind of put in kind of another space of life, where they were kind of non-persons. Because what were they? They weren't observing the Roman cults. They weren't worshiping the Roman gods. That meant that they were pretty much excluded from the social life of their society. You have to understand that in those days, religion was not separated from everyday life the way that it is today. One of the reasons I think that the governors of all the states have been so slow to address the church in their decisions is because people view religion as something that you do on Sunday, and everybody, you know, some people do it and some people don't do it. It's kind of a casual thing, and it's not that significant, it's not that important. We can deal with that last. You know, we can deal with that right after we deal with, you know, all the other more important parts of the economy. Because churches don't add to the economy. They don't, you know, there's all these things. So it's kind of been pushed to the side. And it's kind of a thing people do, but they don't really need it. You know, that's kind of how society views faith and religion. It's not that important. In the ancient world, religions functioned much more the way that Islam functions. Now, we don't like to use Islam as an example because we tend to think of Islam as being very extreme, but think about how deeply integrated Islam is into the lives of every Muslim. Right? They every day they do their prayers. Every day they have their pillars that they have to observe. It is their life. It's one of the reasons why you can't take a Muslim country and just hand them democracy, Western democracy, and say, you're all free. Islam means submission. You can't just do that. they don't have the framework for it. They have to understand it. It takes a long time to learn it, to learn to have kind of our way of individual determinism. But if you look at Islam and the way that it is so deeply integrated into life, that's very much the way Roman religions were, that's the way that Judaism was, that's the way that ancient religions were in that world. It was not something you just did on Sunday. Every day had a religious significance to it. And so when you got up in the morning, you lit some incense at the family altar. That's what you did. And if you walked by a temple, you had to make an offering. And if a holy beggar came and asked you for something, there were rules to Roman society. Well, when Christians threw away the relationship to the Roman deities, and most importantly, when Christians refused to call to worship the genus, or the genius, the entity of the emperor, it put them in a very bizarre position. And so when we look at kind of our world, and we look at Philippians here, we're going to see a lot of similarities. So here's what Paul says in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 12. Therefore, my beloved, my friends, my deepest acquaintances, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Now, I want you to understand what he's talking about here when he talks about salvation. Let me ask you a question. Where was Paul when he wrote this letter? He's in prison. Now, he's probably in house imprisonment. But he is every day being dragged to the Palatine Hill to see whether Nero is going to hear his case or not. He is restricted, and he earlier in the book of Philippians asks the people to pray for his salvation, that he is in bonds. And when he says this, he's not necessarily talking about your salvation as in you're saved, you go to heaven, but rather your freedom from the bonds of this world. Now he's got a lot in focus, but he says if you're willing to work out your relationship, your salvation with, you better do it with fear and trembling. If you think you can do it on your own, if you think you can just make up your faith, you better be ready. You think you can just pretend that things are the way that you want them to be. It is God who works in you both to will and to do and to work for his good pleasure. Now remember, Paul is imprisoned. So when he says, when it is God's to work in you, both to will and to do, and to work for his good pleasure, then that means that Paul, in prison, he is there for God to will and to do his good pleasure. Paul is okay with his situation because God, he trusts God, is doing things in his life. Now, if you're a Philippian believer, and you're operating outside of the restrictions of being a Roman citizen, and everybody's noticing, when you don't offer incense to the family gods, when you enter your workplace and you don't say a silent prayer to the genius of the emperor, right? When you walk by a temple and you're not buying the meat from the temple because it's been offered to false gods, and you've got your own cow to slaughter, you don't need that meat. Right? When you're gathering, they're gathering on Saturday night, early in the morning, on Sunday, really, and they're gathering for their worship services, and they're singing these songs that nobody knows, and these homes, the homes of the Philippian believers, these churches, are lit up at a time when Romans don't light up houses, and they're singing songs that nobody knows, and they're talking about a Christos, a God that no one worships. They're under a lot of pressure. Are they going to be imprisoned or are they going to be free? Are they going to be experience salvation in Christ that is, he is doing will to work for their good pleasure? Then he says to them, he gives them a list of things. Now, this is a great list that parents use with kids, but it's not really what that's about. Verse 14, he says, do all things without grumbling or disputing. Now, he's not talking about doing all the things you want to do. Because nobody grumbles about the things you want to do. right? Except working out. Everybody grumbles about that. But you don't grumble and dispute and complain about the things that you want to do. What do you grumble and dispute and complain about? The things you don't want to do. And Paul is saying, hey, you're going to have to do things you don't want to do if you're to live a worthy life in a world where you're a non-person, where everybody's watching you. Guess what? You're going to have to do things you don't like, and you're going to have to do them without grumbling and complaining. Now, granted, he's never had to deal with Windows 10. But it still applies, all right? We do things without grumbling. Doing all of these things, it means doing the things that are visible, that are public. Because, like I talked about last week, the only Christ that most people in the world will see is you. And so, if people see you grumbling and complaining, they assume that that's what Christians do. That's what Christ calls them to do. And he follows on, verse 15, that you may be blameless and innocent. Now remember what I just said. These are the things that we don't want to do so that people see us. So therefore, when he talks about being blameless and innocent, is he talking about us actually being like spiritually blameless and innocent, like perfect, blameless, unblemished people? No, we know that that's not the case. But when people look at us, are we without flaw and transparent so that as we do things, people see Christ? Now, Paul is setting an ideal. Again, he didn't have to grab a Windows 10. He didn't have to drive with Massachusetts people. All right? So we are facing challenges he didn't face, but I think he's okay with the giving us that advice. But Massachusetts, I got to tell you guys, how many of you have driven recently in the parking lot where the Guitar Center is in Nashua? Where Trader Joe's and everything. I don't know what happened, but nobody is following the rules in that parking lot. I don't know if it's like there was an agreement that was passed. I was sitting waiting, my wife and daughter were in the Guitar Center looking at bongos, because, you know, to be true. And we were there, and I had both the dogs in my car, so I was trying to distract myself from the yapping and the panting and the whining and the crying. And because the windows didn't go down, because, like, this is another side tangent, but what's with the new keyless cars? If the key is out of the car, you can't bring the window down. Have you noticed this? My wife left, she had the key in her pocket. I'm sitting there going, anyway, so I was passing time watching people drive, and I swear to you, I have no idea where these people learned to drive. They were going the wrong way on the wrong side of the road. They were driving down the parking lines, where the parking spaces. They're driving right down the middle of them, people pulling through handicapped spots, and then somebody trying to pull into the handicapped spot. And so rather than back out of the spot that they're not supposed to be in, I watched somebody actually inch around the person trying to pull in the handicapped spot so they could go on the wrong side of the road. I'm sitting there going, people's brains have fallen out. And so it was really, really hard for me at that point to not grumble and complain and not whine. Well, I couldn't wind the window down, so that was safe. But yell at people saying, go back to school. My daughter's going to driving lessons. You should go too. But to drive, to be blameless and innocent, children of God. And here's where it's so important. It says, without blemish, in other words, to be transparent, a perfect glass, to see through. I don't know about any of you, but I have this thing. My glasses, I chip glasses the second I get them. For some reason, I just cannot keep glasses in. And that's one of the reasons I own these. These cost $10, I think. Because I figured, what's the point? I'm just going to break them anyway. I might as well just buy cheap glasses and just, you know. But that idea of without blemish, it means that you look through and what they see is what they get. There's no warping, there's no bending. In the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Now, I shared this on Facebook last week, and I talked a little bit about it, but This, what Paul is doing, now Paul is infamous for mixing metaphors, so you just got to get used to it. So he says you're blameless, you're flawless, and then he says because we live in a crooked and twisted generation, he's not talking about the sin of the people. It's important that you understand what he's talking about. He's not talking about people who are sinners so they're twisted and broken, but rather he's describing a situation. And if you think of, if you've ever been out on the ocean, all right? Now today we have all these GPSs and navigation and radar and all this stuff, navigational charts. But if you're ever out on water when suddenly the fog covers up everything and you can't see anything, no matter how hard you try, you will not navigate in a straight line. Right? You got your oars, you're sitting there going, oh, I think I gotta go left, or I think I gotta go right. I mean, I don't really understand the concept why your back is to wherever you're going when you're rowing a boat anyway. But you're all over the place, you're deviating, and no matter how hard you try, you wind up not where you intended to be. Right? It's just how it is, it's so disorienting. Well, in a world where you navigate by the stars, if you don't know where the stars are, you can't see the stars, and you're just relying on the currents. And Leo, who's a what's your official certification as a sailor?
Advanced pilot.
All right, he's an advanced pilot, right? So Leo will tell you that currents, they tend to kind of do this. You can get caught. A lifeguard will tell you that there's rip currents and there's backward currents and the wind's blowing and things are moving. When you're in a boat and you've got no way to navigate, you're twisted. You're going to wind up all over the place. You're going to wind up in every possible direction. And Paul describes the generation he lives in and says, look, he says, they're chartless, starless. They have no helmsman, their navigation is blown, they're being blown about by every wind. He says, and you, as Christians, are supposed to be blameless and innocent and shining as lights in the world, literally stars in the sky. Because if a navigator can see one star he recognizes, he can figure out everything else he needs to go in a straight line and get to the right direction. If a navigator can take one reading, why? Why can you navigate by the stars? Because they are consistent, they are reliable, and if you can see them, they will always take you where you need to go. I learned that lesson from Juan. Some of you can think about that. No, the reality is you can navigate from the stars. If you can find the North Star, if you can find certain navigating stars, you can follow them. Now, if you mistake a planet for a star, you're going to be in trouble. You mistake Venus for Polaris, you're going to wind up going the wrong direction because planet means wanderer for this reason. But once you see those stars, but you know what? The stars would be useless for navigation if they changed whenever the wind blew. If they weren't so distant and consistent, constant, and reliable. And Paul says, you live in a world where people are desperate for a solid, consistent navigational guide. And you are called to be stars. So be blameless. Be committed to what you are as a star. You are a guide as a star. You are not, and Christians, you need to understand this, you are not responsible for all the social ills of the world. Our job as the church is not to walk around trying to fix every problem that crops up. Our job as the church is to point people to Christ, to be stars. Stars don't come down and go, you need to go left. Go left, go left. No, recognize I'm pointing right. That's why I don't matter. All right? Go left, go left. That's not how it works. The navigator has to see the star and trust the star. And you know what? And I use this example, and I got all kinds of interesting conversations this week when I quoted Mark Niemöller, who is the guy that's infamous for saying that he never actually said this, but he said they came for the communists, we didn't say anything. They came for the Nazis, they came for the Jews, we didn't say anything. When they came for us, there was nobody left to say anything. That's an infamous quote. It's a legendary quote. It's in the Holocaust museums and all kinds of stuff. He actually said something very similar. But Niemöller was actually, he was a Nazi sympathizer early on, and then realized where the Nazis were going. And so he left, he joined the confessional church, but he still stayed quiet about the injustices because he thought, he argued, and the same argument was actually used in the 70s and early 80s by the current Pope in Argentina, who said the best response would just to not say anything so that way we can stay in the public eye when we keep speaking if we don't address it. And Niemöller actually wrote a thing called the Confession of Guilt, where he confessed his guilt in what the Nazis had done. And everybody reads that, and it's funny because I posted on Facebook and everybody thought, well, what are we guilty of? We're not guilty of racial segregation. We're not guilty of inciting riots. We're not guilty. Christians aren't guilty of those things. Most of us are not involved in those things. Now, if you're guilty of those things and you repent of them, what we are guilty of is not being shining lights in the midst of chaos. If we are guilty of being silent, when the gospel can address a situation, you want to know how to get racial reconciliation in America? Focus on Christ being the Savior of mankind. Focus on the reality that when we look at Christ, all the things that we use as racial criteria are nonsense. And turn the focus to Christ. You say, well, that won't fix any real problems. Hopefully it'll call people to Christ, and I think that fixes problems. I could be wrong, but I think that if we keep our focus on Christ, if we speak Christ, then we are stars. Because the world needs us to be consistent, bright, light that they can navigate according to. And unfortunately, so often the church is so consumed with being in the spotlight that they're not willing to be the starlight. You know, when a spotlight is shining, you can't see the stars. And I know this because right now I can't see your faces because there's a spotlight shining in my face. We are not called to make the show. We're called to be the star. Not a star as the way that we describe stars. But when somebody is wandering and lost in the world, where do they look for the voice of consistency, reason, and truth? And ask yourself this honest question. Do people think they can trust the church to be that guide? Not Bedford Road, the church, big C. Is that the place where people turn for stars to navigate by? Or do the vast majority of people think, like I mentioned at the beginning, that the church is just a thing that people do on Sunday, it's not that big of a deal, it doesn't really have any impact on who they are? So we're called to be stars. We're called to be navigational waypoints. And it's a funny thing. I'll just leave you with this. Paul uses this image so well. You know that to follow a star is not to get to the star. It's to get to your destination. You never get to the star. You use the star to get to the destination. Because the star's purpose, and I believe, and I know I'm going to sound wacky, but in Genesis chapter 1, the scripture of Genesis says, the stars were given to us as signs. I believe that God put the stars in the sky to direct people, to guide us to himself. And God put you in the constellation of the sky, of the world, of the people that you live around and interact with, to be a star. To take them somewhere, not to you, but to him. Verse 16, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ, how do you become a star? Right here. holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Holding fast to the word of life. How does a Christian be a star? You just hold fast to Christ. Mm-hmm. You shine his light. And you call people to follow him. You say, well, they won't listen. They won't follow me. They don't care. That's not your concern. Our faith is not determined by whether people listen or not. Our faith is not determined by whether the world likes us or not. Our faith is determined by us being the light of Christ shining in the world. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Father, help us to shine, to be lights. All of us are called to different roles in different places in the starscape. Some are suns, and some are burning bright, and some burn short, and some burn long, and some burn red, and some burn white. But Lord, in all these ways that we might show you, manifest you in all that we do, how we live, how we journey, how we worship. That when those who do not know you come into the assembly of this congregation, what they see is the praise of Christ. And they're called and drawn to you, and not to us. And Lord, as we minister in our world, as we minister in situations where there are racial tensions and economic concerns and political arguments, Lord, that we might first and foremost shine forth your word, your truth, your life, your son. May be glorified in all we do and say. We pray this in Jesus' name. I invite you to join me. We're going to join in receiving the Lord's table. Hopefully you grabbed one of the packets or brought something from home. I know there are a few people that just loaded up on crackers and said we're just going to carry crackers around in our pockets when we go to church. The new normal, right? The new normal. Face mask in one pocket and communion crackers in the other. The Apostle Paul, I think this is important as we observe this. Let me just say this. It's been tremendous. I have to thank, not that I'm trying to puff him up or anything, but I have to thank Ray P. for setting up the communion schedule and inviting the men who have shared the devotionals. They, especially during the Zoom times, it was just tremendous to hear their voices. And to hear the communion messages that they've shared, and that he coordinates all that. I really don't know who's doing communion until I look at the schedule, which is great. It's a huge part of our worship, and so I'm thankful for doing that. And now we've been doing this for, I want to say, we've been doing it since September, October, doing it every Sunday, something like that. I don't know, October, November, somewhere in there. And, you know, people that were worried about it not being fresh and not being... It's been so extraordinary to just participate in this. But I want to invite you to consider the Apostle Paul's instructions, remembering that everything in his life is about a testimony for Christ. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, when he gives the instructions on how to observe communion in the service, he says in verse 18, 11, 18, he says, "For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And I believe it in part, for there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you must be recognized." He says, you know, it's crazy. He says, but something that calls us to unity, it also calls us to recognize what doesn't unite us. And then when we see what doesn't unite us, then we recognize our need for Christ to be our uniting power, his spirit to draw us together. To bring us into, to keep borrowing Paul's metaphor, to bring us into a constellation that invites people to Christ. And he talks about when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you come to eat, because their focus was all on the party. It was all on, you know, best seats and finding great places, which, by the way, is why I just have such a hard time. Not that it's wrong to do reservations and sign-up sheets for church, but I just have a hard time assigning people seats in church. You know, it's like, well, you sit here because you have fine clothes and rings, and I think James says something about doing that. We want you to be able to come and worship as you are. He talks about going in and worshiping in their houses. But then he makes this single statement that should have solved all of the communion problems in the Corinthian church. He says this, I received from the Lord that I also deliver to you. Can I be honest with you? That should be the end of every argument in the church. If somebody's arguing about something and you say, well, what did Jesus say about it? And Jesus actually spoke on that subject, that should really be a moot point. If you're still arguing after Jesus is part of the conversation, you know, I mean, let's be honest about that. We don't have that problem at Bedford Road, but I mean, we've all been in churches where it's like, argue, 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 and it's like, what does Jesus have to say about it? What does Christ have to say about it? I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. And then he recounts when then Jesus, and every word Paul chooses is so important. He's talking about disunity. He's talking about selfishness and communion. And what does he say? On the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. Jesus says at the moment, the greatest division amongst the disciples, Jesus called them to unity in him. Isn't that great? Jesus addressed it. He knew what was going on, and he still calls them to unity. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. I invite you to take the bread, which we use to remember the body of Christ, which is broken for us. And join me in a word of prayer. I'll let y'all fiddle with that plastic. It's so annoying. Yes, it is a piece of styrofoam. It's edible styrofoam, I think. I don't know what it's made of, but let's join in prayer. Father, we thank you not that this element that we receive somehow supernaturally becomes the body of Christ, but rather that we, in this moment, as we remember his body broken, we remember the unity that he brings us into, that his brokenness brings us together, that the darkness of his death turns us into lights of the world. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And receive the body of Christ. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper. And again, remember, he chooses every word carefully. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Because the old covenant was in the blood of animals, of lambs and goats. And it could never be fulfilled in ourselves. But in Christ, it is completed. The new covenant is a completed covenant. It is not one that we hope to attain to the requirements of it, but rather it is completed in Christ. And Hebrews deals with that. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Would you join me in prayer again? Father, thank you for a new covenant complete in Christ. That our faith is not about what we are doing, but rather what Christ has done. And Lord, as we celebrate this new covenant, as we rejoice in all that it means, and the way that you empower us to be witnesses in ways we could never be, may we remember you not as the past, but as the present and the future of all that we are. Again, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Do this in remembrance of you. For as often as you drink, eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Would you stand with me? Let's sing the doxology as a benediction. Because it's been 3 months, Bob, since we sang the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host.
go in peace and be light.